touching on that. And now I invite His Excellency, Mr. Ron Keller. He's an international expert on geopolitics, finance, trade, and investment, and is a former ambassador of the Netherlands to China, Russia, Ukraine, and Turkey. Looking forward. Over to Mr. Ron Keller. Yeah, please.
Yes, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you very much for inviting me and having me in your panel. Thank you, Mr. Jasbir Singh and everybody from FCCI for bringing us together and for bringing forward such an excellent piece of work and an excellent conference today. Thank you very much for that. You mentioned I was a former Dutch ambassador. That means that whatever I say now is purely out of my own responsibility. That gives me the ability to speak a little bit freer, maybe. But at the same time, I am and I will remain Dutch. So you will recognize a lot of the Dutch government's position in what I am saying. Let me first state: everybody knows that, certainly since you're based in the Netherlands and in The Hague, that the Netherlands is a true believer in multilateral cooperation. We are, for all kinds of reasons, if only because of our geographical location and our size, we are bound to be part of multilateral international structures that cooperate and that work towards a common goal. We are very, very strong believer in multilateralism. We believe that already in 1945, after some wise lessons and tragic wars, and we believe that even stronger, and I think today is full of statements, correct statements about how the world has moved on from 1945 onwards, has been globalizing with ups and downs, but every aspect of the human beings' lives nowadays, wherever you are on the face of this earth, is beyond the nation state, whether it's economic relationship, whether it's personal connections relationship, migration, terrorism was already mentioned, crime, but also trade, investment. Everything that we touch upon nowadays has full of international relations. And the logic that FCCI so rightly put forward, and also the Indian presidency, I think, of the G20, that we've moved from a family to a community to nation states. And why did we do that? Simply because the challenges that we faced in the past moved on, went beyond the scope of our organization. And then you organize yourself at that level where you can tackle those issues, where you can benefit from the corporation and iron out the deficiencies of what individuals or societies or countries are doing. That is the logic and made us as human beings scale up continuously. It is understandable and it's inevitable and it's deeply desirable that we continue to scale up simply because we will not survive. And I'm not a doom thinker, but face it, if we do not peacefully cooperate on this face of this earth, we will lose not only precious time, but we will never solve the challenges that our children and their children will face. The issues is not only about climate, but it's about natural resources, biodiversity, all these issues that are not issues of luxury, but are issues of our deep existence as organisms on this earth. And this only can be solved by peaceful international cooperation. And with peaceful global, truly global cooperation on those issues that require globalized action and governance, obviously we need to have institutions that are up to standard and that are preferably even forward-looking if it comes to the challenges ahead of us. And in that respect, it is clear, and the FCCI's paper made it clear, I think all the speakers made it clear, the current multilateral system is outdated. It is simply not delivering now what it needs to do, and it will certainly not deliver what our children and grandchildren require to survive. So we need to reform, and I very much am tempted also to say, let's throw everything out that doesn't work and let's start with a new engine, a new multilateral framework. But I do agree more and more, listening also to these various speakers, let's not do that. We have the risk that we will create another institution because we hardly abolish anything. We're not so good at that as mankind. So let's just reform what we have. And the UN, it was stated earlier and it was in the previous panel, has delivered tremendous benefits already. We can only but to build on those and make our UN better and stronger and more relevant. Now, this is something which I think all of us agree upon. The question is how to do it, and there it goes wrong. And that is why I like the FCCI paper so very, very much, because Jasper, you were right. You mentioned that so many statements about we need reform, we need to strengthen. Even Ron Keller said it in this afternoon. But how? Who puts it on paper? Who starts to think? And I think your paper is really, really very, very praiseworthy. I really, really recommend it to be worked upon further. I truly hope your presentation will go to New York and to any member state that wants to hear about it and wants to think about it. Thank you for that. But there is a but coming, ladies and gentlemen, so... Very Dutch, yeah, maybe. Let me first say that I agree with the analysis. We can be short on that. The UN faces basically imbalance. It is not equitable in its representation. It lacks proactive and even decision-making when it's needed. When war breaks out, we look the other way. We don't do anything. Lack of democratic representation in the UN is clear. Lack of resources, I would say predictable resources, is something which the Netherlands has always been fighting for. We need to empower our UN with sufficient funds. Just a little sidestep, commenting on the statement of our Bolivian ambassador, I think I very much agree with you. Be cautious with private sources, well-intended as it is, but if we would all reduce our expenditure on military, just on arms, with 1 or 2%, we have a fantastic funding base for the UN. Isn't that worth it? 1 or 2% less military expenditures. So I would look into that direction much more. I would subscribe basically to the fact that we need to start working on tax and on reforms. And as I said, your paper is very, very welcome because it's very practical. At first and also at second glance, it looks extremely reasonable. And here comes the but, ladies and gentlemen. I think we need much more. At the risk... And I say here, there are two ways of going. Either you say, let's just try to achieve, I think you, sir, mentioned it, we better just use little steps based on, we've heard a Russian representative stating, and the other four would have the same statement, let's not change the veto system, for instance. So we have to be practical and pragmatic. I understand that. But allow me, because the sun is shining and we're all having such a wonderful meeting, allow me to dwell a little bit on how maybe even better reform could look like, if only because it may be something to keep in mind for a new version of the paper. Again, the colleague from Bolivia said rightly so, and others as well, Ambassador Yemen and others, peace and security is not only the Security Council, and peace and security is not only provided by means of force or by means of intervention or peacekeeping. Economic integration and cooperation are equally powerful if it comes to fostering peace and security. So if you look at the UN with all its different funds and resources, actually the whole of the UN needs to be strengthened. It would be a pity if we would only do the Security Council and leave all the other valuable, equally valuable parts of the UN untouched. They all struggle with the same problem of how to represent, how to find legitimacy, how to find equitable participation, and how to be effective, how to get resources and have the empowerment to be effective. All of them face the same problem. I just throw, not to write a new paper, but just throw into the group. There is a system, actually, it's in a UN specialized agency, actually two of them, that works quite well in terms of legitimation and in participation, and that is the constituency system that the IMF and the World Bank have. Now, can be all reformed and so, but there you see the same ideas that the FCCI paper has, a kind of a formula for to represent the country weights constituency to facilitate decision making, but every country in this on this earth is part of a constituency, is directly or indirectly connected to the decision making. Not 25 members in the Security Council, but 193 through a constituency system. That would bring a lot of reforms. I understand that, but there is an example, Steel with Pride, from UN and World Bank, where this already works. And last but not least, I would like to mention that the UN needs to be empowered not only with resources, but it also needs to have a mandate to enforce. And what I mean with that is the following. I mean, if you don't stop in the Netherlands for a red traffic light, as you have noticed, you get penalized by the Dutch police. That simply enforces the simple traffic rules that we agreed in this country. By majority, by the way, I said to my Russian friend, by majority, it cannot be that everything is decided by consensus. No company, no organization, no family, no group runs on the basis of consensus, because it comes to a halt. Consensus sounds so reasonable, but in practice, it's highly undemocratic and ineffective. So we have to do away with all the veto powers, and we have to look at different powers, and that is a mandate of the UN to really enforce. And I give an example, climate. I mentioned climate, and then I stopped, Mr. Chair. I gave an example on the climate. We have now Paris agreements. We have voluntary agreement to do better with our climate action plans. But who is making sure that actually all of us are living up to what we agreed upon? Who is making sure that there is consistency between what we're doing? And it's a bit like with the Security Council. There is no enforcement upon these climate. We will be too late, too little, too late. And therefore, we need to have also more executive powers of the UN. It means the national governments have to give up some of their national decision-making. But didn't we do that also on a national level? And that works in all of our countries very well. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Excellency, Mr. Ron Keller. Excellent. And now I invite...